Remember, we were talking about minimal cones, and we had this Simon's cone in R2M. N is the dimension, but here it's an even dimension, and it was this guy, x prime square equals x double prime square, or yeah, this equals this, where x is x prime, x double prime is in Rm cross Rm, and you check that it had minimal zero mean curvature. So it's a minimal surface, it's a candidate to be minimizing. And the theorem that we proved, theorem one, is that if the dimension is greater or equal than 8, then CS is minimizing. Minimizing area, okay? And the proof, I made a mistake, but already tomorrow, yesterday, you saw it corrected, say. The function that you have to take, it's not this one, it will not work with the square. You have to take another power. Power 4, for some reason, algebraic reason, works. And then you consider this vector field, which is grad u over mod grad u, unit vector field. You compute its divergence. That gives you the mean curvature of the level sets. Okay? And the thing to check, the exercise is to check, and this is the key point, that this has the same sign as U, has the same sign as U. So when X prime is bigger than X double prime, it's positive, otherwise it's negative. But this only if the dimension is greater or equal than 8, okay? So, so, and the proof was building a very easy argument, a calibration argument, using this vector field X and the divergence theorem, okay? Quite simple. These are what happens in up to dimension 7? Are there minimizing minimal cones other than the hyperplanes or not? And as you will see now, the answer is not. So, but for that, let us recall that if H, so if C is a cone now, so the boundary of E, C, is a cone, which means that a cone means simply that if a point is in the cone, then all the positive multiples of X is also in the cone, are also in the cone. What if you want for E, the same thing for E? If X is in E, lambda X is in E for every positive scalar lambda. Okay, so this is the definition of cone. And we had already computed the second variation. In case that H is zero, the mean curvature is zero, then the second variation of energy was this. Second variation of energy at E equals zero. And energy is the perimeter of those sets in a ball, say, of radius r. And this is an integral in the boundary of E. And here I will take, since I'm taking in BR, I will take C, a nice function, say C1, with compact support in this ball, okay? So that nothing happens outside the ball. And the formula is this. Tangential derivative of psi along tangential along the cone, okay? So this is the cone, this is the origin, E is here, this is C, the cone here. So tangential gradient, Riemannian gradient on the cone, say, minus C square psi square, where C square is the second fundamental form square, which is the sum of the squares of all the principal curvatures, the n minus one principal curvatures of the surface or of the cone. Okay. So now on the cone we will need an operator which is what comes from integrating by parts here, and this is the Laplace-Beltrami operator. So you should review a little more about it, but let me just give it a name. Let me call it LV for Laplace-Beltrami. I mean, I can do this in a cone or in any surface. Huh? Here, E could be also a boundary of E, could be also any hyper surface, and define in the same way Laplace-Beltrami of a function. Well, it's in fact the divergence of the tangential gradient of the function, and this is the divergence, the boundary of on the manifold. So it's the tangential gradient and tangential divergence, and the key point is that it's where it comes after integration by parts there. So the second variation now becomes the integral in boundary of E, if you want, minus Laplace-Beltrami of psi minus C squared psi times psi. So this is what we call the linearized operator, okay, to the problem. Linearized operator at this. So we have an energy which is the perimeter. You make the first variation and you get this equation, H equals zero. Mean curvature equals zero. Now you make the second variation, and it appears the linearization of the first variation of H equals zero. So if you make the first variation, say, the variation of the equation, you get the second variation, and you always have behind it a linear problem where you linearize at your cone, okay, or at your surface. And it's a second order, you see, it's a second order operator, Laplace minus a potential. Always with this sign, bad sign, dangerous sign. This is positive, and you are subtracting something. So we are asking stability is stable, means exactly that this operator should be non-negative definite for functions with compact support. So stability means exactly that this is greater or equal than zero. It is exactly this. And the theorem is this one. Yeah. No. Psi is a function. Well, you missed the first talk. The perturbations, you perturb the set E into a set ET, which is a diffeomorphism applied to E, and the diffeomorphism is of the form identity plus T times a scalar function of the point times the normal. So psi is, everything is scalar. From now on, everything will be scalar, okay? And this is like what you are used for Schrodinger operators or Laplace minus a potential. The theorem is 1 year before the one of Bombieri de Giorgi Giusti from yesterday, that was 69. This is from 68, and this is James Simons, okay? Simons, 68. Very important paper in the Annals of Math. It says if you have a stationary cone, so it has zero mean curvature and it is stationary, and assume this, and that is stable. And the cone is stable. Second variation of area greater or equal than zero. And assume for simplicity that Rn minus the cone is smooth. The cone minus the origin is smooth. You see, you could have two planes in R3. You could have one plane here and another plane here. And the origin would be here, these two planes. Okay, the table and this. And this is a cone, but the origin is here. But then there is this line of intersection, right? And there, the set is not smooth. But these, at the end, are easy objects to study. So the key point is, this is not big deal. We are going to assume that the only singular point is the origin, OK? So let me write it like this. If the set E is a minimizer, is a minimal set, you have everything. So all these holes, if E has minimal perimeter, because minimality gives you criticality, but it also gives you that the second variation of energy, being a minimizer, is non-negative, okay? So the class of stable solutions is a little larger. Then, if n is equal,
sorry, yeah. Minimizing doesn't apply that the only singularity is a pointless, right?
No. Ah, no, not this, but sorry. Not this, but stationarity plus stability, sorry. Okay. Well, it would also imply yes, but stationary and stability hold if E has minimal perimeter. Thank you. Then, if the dimension is less or equal than 7, it must be a hyperplane. So this is the theorem, and as I told you, this is the main part on the regularity theory of minimal surfaces. Okay, you have to prove this. Okay, so let's start the proof. Let's just start the proof. Towards the proof, say this is a key point. But important points for the proof. It's a technicality, but it's important. Replace psi, which is arbitrary function, say, with compact support, by a special function that we will find. I will call it d times eta, and eta at the end will be also arbitrary. Okay. So let's just do some algebra. Put here psi equals d times eta, and see what you get. And I would like to have something, to see something for d also, okay? And well, we get this. Let's do the computation. It's very simple. This is greater or equal than 0, delta psi squared minus c squared psi squared. I write what is this now. So delta psi, delta of a product, that's very easy. Delta d square, eta square, plus d square, delta eta square. The double product, I will write it like this. D delta of d, d delta of d times delta of eta square. Let me write it like that. That's the double product. And then minus c square, d square, eta square. Okay. And now I integrate by parts. And I throw this derivative here to this guy, and also to this guy. Eta also has compact support. There are no boundary terms. It has compact support, and if you want, also away from the origin, if you want to avoid this point. So suppose that eta does whatever, and it has compact support in the ball of radius r. But if you want, also you remove a neighborhood of the origin because of the singularity. And eta lives here, okay? It's a scalar, huh? Okay. Let's integrate by parts. When you put it here, you get d this term, sorry, when you put it here, you get this term with a minus. So this one goes away with this one. So we just get d squared delta d, delta eta squared minus eta squared, common factor, I guess, yeah, or let's put it at the end. And we get, this is gone. This I already wrote. When I put the derivative here, it's, no, I made a mistake, right? When I put the derivative here, I get delta d, delta d, delta d squared, which is this one with a minus. So now I have to put it here. And I get the Laplace Beltrami with a minus. Because, okay, now we need this, sorry. We need this formula also. Laplace Beltrami of a function is delta of delta v. So delta squared v, say. Okay? It's like this formula here. Okay? Like this. Well, delta, or maybe I should write divergence, maybe better. Yeah. Maybe I should write divergence of delta. Yes. Yeah, maybe it's more correct. Yeah, divergence. I'm in a Riemannian manifold. I take a I throw a tangential gradient to a vector field. That's the divergence of this vector field, and the divergence of a vector field is the Laplace of the tangential derivative of a function is the Laplace Beltrami. Okay, so we get this term with a minus. So let me write it like this: Laplace Beltrami of d. Laplace Beltrami of d times d times eta squared. And if this other term, I don't do anything to it. I just take a eta, a d eta squared here, so I get c squared d. And again, you see the linearized operator here. This is the linearized operator with a plus now. With a plus applied to the linearized operator. Okay, and now the trick of Simons is to take, so the linearized operator is coming up all the time, and what you need is to find functions that solve a certain equation, not the homogeneous equation, but with a reminder, for the linearized equation. And
there is a
plus here, huh? Yes, thank you. You need to find in all this story about stable solutions and trying to prove that things are rigid, hyperplane, you need to find an appropriate subsolution or super solution, say, with reminder terms for the linearized operator. Okay? And this is Simon's lemma. But first, what he chooses is to take d equals c. So this is the thing. Choose d equals c, which is the second fundamental form without d squared, without the square. And then what we get is the following. So then stability and stationarity, but I don't write it, implies that this term here, Laplace Beltrami of C plus I will write it like this plus C times Laplace Beltrami plus C square times eta square less or equal than C square grad eta square. Correct? Yes, because I have C4. Yeah, C4, because D equals C. So this is the, but if you want, this is again the same as C times the linearized operator applied to C. It's a quadratic form, you see again. And then integrate it. Okay. And now this is usually written in this way because it's not convenient to find the Laplace-Beltrami of C. It's better to compute the Laplace-Beltrami of C squared. But the Laplace of a square divided by 2 is the C times Laplace of C plus grad of C squared. So I have to subtract here gradient, tangential gradient of C square, and then C4. And all these multiplying eta squared. So this is the inequality. I will write it again here. This is the inequality. And now it comes the main point, Simon's lemma, lemma 3. This is called like Simon's lemma, and it's a key point. And this is going to be painful to prove it, but I'll give you the ideas later on or tomorrow. If it says if boundary of E is a stationary cone, any stationary cone, here stability is not needed. Stability is not needed here. We already used the stability. Then this guy here, 1/2 Laplace Beltrami of C squared minus delta C squared plus C to the power 4 is greater or equal than 2x squared C squared on the cone. Minus the origin, we always remove the origin where there is singularity. The cone has a vertex at the origin always, huh? So this is the lemma. As you see,
so that's the
n smaller than the no, any n. I wrote here, I didn't write it here. Any n, good, thanks. Any n. Well, maybe n greater or equal than. Maybe n greater or equal than 3. No, even with 2. Well, anyway, in the plane, any cone is just a line. This is C0, 0, 0, 0, 0. So, anyhow. Okay, now using the lemma, we can prove theorem 2 very easily. So, completion of the proof of theorem 2 using lemma 3. And that's easy. And you will see that's very easy. Because you put it here, huh? You put this here, this inequality, everything is positive, so I can write now that that is larger or equal than this, so I can write that 2x squared, 2 over x squared, eta squared, c squared, eta squared, yes, less or equal than c squared gradient eta squared, okay? And we can write this in this way, 0 is less or equal in an integral on the boundary B. And here you see there is common factor of C squared. And what we get is the gradient of eta squared minus 2 minus 2 over x squared eta squared, everything multiplying C squared. And now the trick is try to make this negative. Let's try to make this negative to get a contradiction unless C is identically zero. But C identically means identically zero means all the principal curvatures identically zero, and therefore you should be a problem. Okay? So let's try to make this negative there. Look that everything rescales well. This is what I was telling you yesterday about Hardy-type potentials. We will talk about this later, the Hardy inequality, because I saw that some of you didn't know about this, Hardy, and it's a very basic tool, and we will prove it later. But already here, you see the homogeneity. This is the comb, so there is an homogeneity. First, here there is a gradient squared, so 1/m² And here also 1/m² So the Laplace and this potential have the same homogeneity. That's very, they fight with the same arms, okay? They have the same power in terms of homogeneity. And this, always look at this when you have a potential subtracting the Laplacian, because now we will take eta, a power, right? A power of the distance to the origin. In fact, they will define it as two powers. So always R is going to be mod x, okay? The distance to the origin. And I will take it to be two different powers. This if R is less or equal than 1, and this if R is greater or equal than 1. Note that they fit, at R equals 1, they fit. And later I will have to cut it off, plus and later say, cut off eta near the origin and at infinity, okay? Not to cheat on you, okay? Not to be cheating. Near x equals 0 and at infinity. But the key point is here. So compute the gradient, and of course is the length of the gradient square is alpha square here times r to the minus 2 alpha minus 2, and here beta square r minus 2 beta minus 2, r less or equal than 1, r greater or equal than 1. And let's try to make this negative, so alpha square less than 2. So I want to take alpha square less than 2, beta square less than 2, and this forces that to be negative. Because eta square over r square is the same, is r to the minus 2 alpha minus 2. Because of the same homogeneity, right? Everywhere, that's going to be negative everywhere after I have to cut off, okay? After I have to cut off. So now a nice exercise. Now I have to cut off, otherwise I'm done, but this makes no sense. Say, this would work in all dimensions. This would work in dimension 8. But in dimension 8, the theorem is true, is false. In dimension 8, the theorem is false because we found a minimizing cone, which is not a plane, right? So where is, so the key point is this one. To cut off, this is the cone, this is infinity, say, this is the origin here. To cut off a function like this, r to the minus alpha, well, you have to be careful, and here r to the minus beta, you have to be careful. You have to cut it off here, and you have to cut it off near infinity. So exercise 4 in my notes, I don't know. Cutoffs work, even only if work, cutoffs, both of them work. If what you get here or here is integrable, sorry, against this, don't forget the c squared. You will have to cut off, but with the c squared. I mean, you are going to cut off the eta, but what do you want? What you want to see at the end is that when you cut off, the integrals don't change too much. The tails go to 0, right? Tails go to 0. Cutoff work means tails in the integrals go to 0 as this parameter epsilon here goes to 0 and as this radius goes to plus infinity, right? So this works as epsilon goes to zero, r goes to plus infinity, if and only if, but let's say if, those integrals are finite. So, for instance, this one here is finite. This is a positive quantity. This is a positive quantity. So if you integrate it on the full cone, it is finite, okay? Sorry? It's gradient, it's whatever I have there. Gradient eta square times c square, exactly. And the other term has the same homogeneity, so I can write this. This is equivalent to the other one being finite also. Eta square, x square, c square being finite. This is the same. And what is this? This is very easy. I use polar coordinates in the cone. There are the angles, but that's compact. And now polar coordinates. The Jacobian is, the dimension of the cone is this, c minus 1. So the Jacobian, you always have to subtract 1. That's a Jacobian. Then delta eta square is there, minus 2 alpha minus 2. And now what happens with c square? That's important. C square, c is curvature. And curvature, remember, always scales as 1 over meter. The curvature of a ball is 1 over the radius, okay? And c square rescales like 1 over meter square. So you have another 2. This minus 2 is coming from c square. So now you make your algebra, and this is r to the n minus 2 minus 6. No. That doesn't look good. Yes, it looks good. N minus 2 minus 6. So n minus 6 minus 2 alpha, right? Okay, and you want this to be, I want this to be integrable at the origin. And I want the other one with 2 beta, minus 2 beta, integrable at infinity. And this is very easy, of course. And we get two inequalities here for alpha and beta, which are that this should be larger than minus 1, and this should be smaller than minus 1. So 2 alpha should be smaller than n minus 5 over 2. And beta should be larger than n minus 5 over 2. And now look at this. If n minus 5 over 2 is smaller than square root of 2, I will take beta in between. In between, both because what I want is beta square less than 2. Remember, beta square less than 2. And this is okay if n is less or equal than 7. Because 7 minus 5 is 2, divided by 2 is 1. 8 is not okay because 8 minus 5 is 3. 3 halves is 1.5, which is not smaller than 1 square root of 2. And for the other one, what I will take is that minus square root of 2, I want this to be smaller than that. And then I will take alpha here. Maybe negative, doesn't matter. I will take alpha here, and alpha square will be less than 2, and alpha will be less than n minus 5 over 2. And this is okay. This is okay if n is greater or equal than 1. Maybe 1 is not okay because minus 1, minus 2 is not, but maybe 2. 2 minus 5 minus 3 minus 1.5, no, n greater or equal than 3. So we are going to prove the theorem in dimension 3 and higher, okay? But in dimension 2, in dimension 2, it doesn't work. It doesn't work. This proof doesn't work. You don't do like this, okay? But think that in dimension 2, a cone are lines, okay? It's a number of lines. So we will discuss that later. Suppose now that we are here, okay? So the proof is finished. The proof is finished. You just have to do this exercise, check the cutoff works. Yeah.
Why does C squared contribute a power of 2 power r?
Sorry?
So C squared is the
C squared is the square of the principal curvatures. And in every ray of the cone, it is constant. So
I see, because it's a cone, it's scaling, so.
Yeah.
So the curvatures are going to 0 and infinity.
So C is an homogeneous, yeah, C, right. Yeah, but even writing, maybe you can write this, C is an homogeneous function of degree minus 1.
Perfect.
And C squared is of degree minus 2, okay?
Right.
So on every, here I did polar coordinates. On every angle, so this function is exactly a function, I don't know how to call it, f of the angles divided by r squared, okay? So I made this computation on every, using polar coordinates on every ray, the angles integrate, and later they will integrate, no problem at all, okay? Okay. So to really finish the proof, you need to do the n equals 2 case, but that you don't do it like this. The algebra like this doesn't work. But it's very simple because in dimension two, a cone is a bunch of lines, right? This is E, this is E, this is E. You only have this option for a cone. And this is clearly not a minimizer. You can also check that it's not stable, okay? But clearly not a minimizer, as we said yesterday, to go this other set here is better, like this, F being like that, removing this part here, F also has this part, and this part is better because it has, if you make a ball of radius R, this thing here has less perimeter. The blue part has less perimeter than the yellow part, right? So for minimality, it's clear. Forget about stability now, but about minimality. N equals 2, the boundary of E has to be aligned, okay? Has to be aligned. And then that assumption that C minus 0 was smooth, you can also remove it because by a dimension reduction argument, because if not, suppose what I was saying before, maybe in the plane, you could have two, in the space, you could have two planes like this, but then you make a section and you are like in the plane, you just do like that, you do a set, the F would be like that, right? So proof is here. That's the key point of the proof, okay? And I, as I was saying, well, and then let me tell you something. What about cones? Now, what if you give me a surface, which is a minimal surface, like a catenoid? The catenoid in R3 is a minimal surface. Is it minimizing or not? Well, it is not. In fact, the catenoid does not minimize area, okay? Does not minimize area because if you have separate enough boundary data, to do all the tube of the catenoid is too much area. It's better to simply stay near the two planes, okay? So that's an argument that has to be proved, but it's easy. But so the theorem, so theorem two implies gives you that if the bound, if E in Rn is minimal set, it's a minimal set minimizer, really minimizer, not only zero mean curvature, and n is less or equal than 7, then it is analytic, it's infinity. Nothing like this that happens in dimension 8 will happen, never will happen. So, but for any set, E could be, I'm not saying that it's a cone, E could be like that. Is it possible for a minimal surface to be like this in R3 or in R4, in R7? No, because it's not infinity, okay? And how do you prove this? There are three elements. The main one is the first one is what it's called to do a blow up method or analysis, which means you look at this point and you blow it up. You make a blow up, a zoom, and in the zoom you get a cone. But to do this step, you need something very important, which is called, but that we are not going to discuss here, which is called monotonicity formula. Maybe some of you will encounter monotonicity formulas also in other elliptic problems, okay? But the minimal surface has a monotonicity formula. You use it to make this blow-up method work and reduce yourself to cones, and then you apply theorem two. You apply theorem two and you're done, because theorem two tells you this will not be minimal. A cone like this cannot be minimal. It has to be a hyperplane. So if you blow up and you get in the limit a hyperplane, it means that the surface was infinity here, okay? Not like that. So all these you find in the book of Tuesday, for instance. And there is another very nice book, which is the one that Tristan mentioned this morning, and I will mention again, Tobias Colding and Minicozzi. Maybe two ends. No, maybe one end. But two C's. I will comment on this book later on also. Okay. So let's go to Harvey inequality. So again, yeah. Any question?
Yeah, sorry. So this this blow up reduces to cones
using the monotonicity formula.
So that sort of shows that the thing is like C1, or when it shows C infinity.
Well, first C1, but that's already.
Okay.
That's the main difficulty. Once you know it's C1, then it's going to be very nice, very flat, then you can prove infinity. It's like for many elliptic equations, once you prove, for instance, for those of you who know about the DeGeorge-Nash-Moser theory, for instance, for elliptic equations with bad coefficients, once you prove that the solution is C alpha, that's the other prize, okay, for Nash, for instance, and will be for DeGeorge also. Nash got the other prize mainly by the theorem, that U is C alpha, and when the coefficients are not assumed to be regular, only uniformly elliptic, okay, but not regular, not even continuous, could be discontinuous. C alpha. If you prove this, you are done then, right, Robert? Because once you prove this, then the coefficients automatically become, not in the linear case. In the in the minimal surface, these you apply to minimal surfaces, for instance, minimal graphs. For minimal graphs, instead of these, you have that. Which is a little nicer. Okay? And this, you can look it as a divergence equation like this. I don't know, you can look it like that. Aij, and these are the coefficients. It's a scalar. So it's a linear equation. But in fact, you don't do this, you differentiate, and you do it for the first derivative. You find an equation for the first derivative, differentiate once. I'm going to do this very fast because this is not in the program, okay? So only for people who know a little and can follow this. You find an equation for the first derivative. You apply the Georgi-Nash theorem, and you get the first derivatives are C alpha. And then you look at these coefficients, which are pretty much this guy. Pretty much is like 1 over square root of this. And since the first derivatives are C alpha, this means U is C1 alpha, which means that the coefficients are C alpha. And once the coefficients are C alpha in an equation of this type, C alpha, then Schauder theory gives you that U is C2 alpha. And you improved a lot. And then you keep differentiating the equation C3 alpha, 4 alpha, C infinity, okay? So that's the tough part here. But that's a good thing to know. This theorem of the Georgi and Nash was designed mainly for other equations also, but mainly for minimal surfaces. So minimal surface theory, and that's why I'm explaining this here, because maybe you are lazy, or I was lazy, or some people are lazy to learn minimal surfaces, because there are many things, many books, you don't know if to start from here or start from there, okay? But my recommendation is that it's good if you learn a little of minimal surfaces, and if you are going to do elliptic and parabolic PDEs, because they are at the heart of most of the developments on elliptic theory and nonlinear and calculus of variations and elliptic regularity in the 20th century, okay? So, and many tools, they are so nice minimal surfaces that most of the tools are present there. You can use divergence form equations, sometimes you can use non-divergence form. There are the monotonicity formulas, there is the blow-up argument, the rigidity theorems, Liouville theorems, everything, with the minimal surface. Okay, so let's speak a little about Harvey inequality. So again, this quadratic form was like that, and this was the same as eta, and this was the same as the linearized operator applied to eta. Times eta, okay? By integration by parts. And in a cone, as there, this operator is of the form, as we wrote, minus Laplace Beltrami, minus a function of the angles, f, that f, over x squared. And this is a Harvey-type operator, in the sense that, by Harvey-type operator, I mean that both terms rescale on the same way. This is meters to the power minus 2, and this is meters to the power minus 2 also, okay? So the question is, when an operator like this is non-negative definite, and when is it not, when it's not? So this is the question. Okay, for which f's? I'm going to discuss the simplest case, and this proposition 4 is the Harvey inequality, okay? Probably some of you know it, but let's do it. Some of you do not know it, okay? And it says, the Harvey inequality only exists also in dimension 3 and higher. There is no Harvey inequality in dimension 2, at least in this form. It says suppose that n is greater or equal than 3, and take a infinity function with compact support in Rn. Then you have this inequality, n minus 2 squared over 4, psi squared over x squared, smaller or equal than grad. So now we go back to Rn, okay? But I could do it in a cone, it would be the same, but let's do it in Rn. And this is the best constant. Is the best constant. You cannot make it larger, it wouldn't be true. And it is not achieved by any function, maybe not with compact support, by H1 function. It is not achieved by any psi in H1 of Rn. And in addition, something that I mentioned yesterday, if you restrict yourself to the unit ball and you take H1 zero function, say, in the unit ball, you would like to define a first eigenvalue for this operator. So the Rayleigh quotient, so the first eigenvalue, say, for the operator is defined by infimum, the quadratic form here in the unit ball, grad psi squared minus, in addition, if now I put a constant bigger than that, if C is bigger than that, I already told you that inequality is not true, because this is the best constant. It's not true. But if this constant is larger, then what you get here, this is a constant. Maybe we shouldn't call it C, not to confuse with the second fundamental form. Okay, let's call it A, and let's put here A, a constant, huh? And here psi squared over x squared. And to define the first eigenvalue, you divide by the L2 norm, right? Divide by the L2 norm. So the claim is that if you put a constant, why did I put a squared? A, right? Huh? A constant larger than this. A, if you put a constant larger than that, this is minus infinity. The first eigenvalue is minus infinity. The bottom of the spectrum is not. I knew that it was going to be negative, because since this is the best constant, if I put a larger constant, this is not going to be true. There must be some negative spectrum. But this thing is saying that it goes to minus infinity. Okay? So, very dangerous to overpass this value. Okay? And this infinity here, it's related to what I told you yesterday, that the solution of the ODE, so this is related, let's write it somewhere, maybe in here. This is totally related with the foliation that we could prove, that we could build in dimension 8, and it cannot be built in lower dimensions. So you have the cone here, the Simon's cone, and you solve an ODE, in fact, because everything gets reduced to two radial variables. Here you have this radial variable, and here you have this radial variable. Everything becomes an ODE. This was done, as I told you, by Bombieri, De Giorgi, Justin. Okay, you can look at their paper. You make the shooting method from this point. You look at the ODE that gives you the minimal surface equation. And in dimension 8, we were getting that beautiful foliation. Well, we didn't get the foliation. We got a a subfoliation or superfoliation by subsolutions or super solutions, it was enough for us. But they built the solutions and they showed that they didn't cross if the dimension is greater or equal than 8. But if you do this in dimension 6 or 4, you don't get this. In dimension 6 or 4, you get that it crosses the cone and it crosses infinitely many times. And the ODE does like this, okay? So this is dimension 4 or 6. And the infinite crossings is exactly a reflect, it is exactly because the bottom of the spectrum here is minus infinity, and there are infinity negative eigenvalues for OD, for this OD, okay? Yes. For the linearization, for minus Laplace Beltrami minus C squared over X squared on the Simons cone, after you write this as an OD.
So this phenomenon happens only in lower dimensions.
In lower dimensions, it happens in lower dimensions because the constant that you get, well, or this function f of eta of the angles that in fact will be a constant that you get is larger than the Hardy, in the Hardy constant. So what we are seeing here is that in dimension 8 and higher, the linearized operator has a constant that is smaller, or at least smaller or equal than the Hardy constant, okay? And in a dimension smaller, it is greater, and that's very dangerous, okay? But the proof that we did, if you see, it doesn't go exactly, I didn't use the Hardy inequality, because in the proof, look, in the proof, there was a C square, there, it's not here anymore, there was a C square factorized. You remember, in the proof we had C squared that multiplies grad eta squared minus. So in fact, it's good that here I kept the psi. Yeah, because it's good that I kept the psi here, because today we started like this, okay? But the original problem was for psi, and you already saw, you saw delta psi squared minus c squared psi squared. And this is what I'm talking about here, okay? Instead, after the trick of Simons, which is called choose psi to be a multiple of the second fundamental form, what you get is something a little different than that. Everything is related, but you get this. You get this. Right? You get this. But C squared is common factor, okay? Here there is no common factor. Here there is no common factor, okay? But that's why the proof, I can do it without using the Hardy inequality. But I could prove it using the Hardy inequality also, so everything is the same. So we cannot prove the Hardy inequality, but as you will see, it's amazingly two lines. So this inequality here, it's two lines, you can think about it if you want, just two lines, and the two lines give you the best constant right away. Right away. So think, how would you prove that if you never saw the proof? But we'll do it tomorrow. So thanks for the attention. Other question? Yes, in the proof, to be rigorous, you have to cut them off, okay? You have to cut them off, but the function that at the end violates the stability, the limiting function before the cutoff or after, you send the cutoff to infinity and to zero, is a power like this. And the function that will make here, for instance, this going to minus infinity or in the inequality will try to achieve the inequality is also a power. But you never get exactly the inequality because you have to, and this because the operator is scaling variant, okay? So that's why a power is exact, so is an exact, so you will find a power that is an exact solution. And then if you have to cut it off, which means lower it here, it will never achieve exactly the equality, okay? In a position with Sobolev inequalities, for instance, where you can achieve the constant with zero boundary values.
So what is the intuition behind the Simon's lemma? the fact that thing is less than or equal to 2.
Okay, that's a key point. I'm debating myself what... No, I'll tell you things about that, okay? It says 1/2 Laplace Beltrami of C squared minus delta C squared plus C4 greater or equal than 2x squared C squared, okay? This for every stationary cone, for every cone with zero mean curvature, and in all dimensions. So this is amazing. And this takes 5 or 6 pages of calculations, okay? And I will indicate how it goes. But we will not do all details because I'm not sure how much would you get from that, because it's computation, but at least I want to give you the tools, the main tools, so that if somebody wants to, this in the book of Chusti, or in the book of Koudina Minikotsi, and are done in very different ways. So I'll tell you the 2 possible ways, and you choose which one you like more. See? So we'll discuss this tomorrow a little. Okay, so thank you.